What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Joe Bonamassa here, and today is my supreme honor to welcome musician, guitarist, singer, writer, producer extraordinaire, the legendary Todd Rundgren to the show. Todd, I have chills. Thank you very much for doing this. I'm a huge fan, and obviously been an admirer my whole life, and I just can't believe I get the opportunity to talk to you today. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you for having me, Joe. I'm a fan.
Thank you.
I started out in a white blues band.
Right.
And so, you know, I have a great appreciation for other white blues men.
it's funny how the blues always seeps into everything, but it was just the kind of music that I would just keep playing the records over and over again. Tell me like how you got started, because, you know, like doing my research for this, I mean, it is mind blowing how many different things you were involved in almost tangentially to each other, you know, record production, writing music, singing, playing in bands. Like who was your host for music via the guitar or anything?
Well, it was pretty apparent that I had a musical mentality when I was really young. I was just like, spend hours and hours listening to music on my little RCA 45 RPM player.
Right.
And when I had the opportunity to rent an instrument in elementary school, thought I wanted to play the flute for starters.
Right.
I liked the sound of it. Didn't realize how difficult it was, so I didn't make a lot of progress with that. I made more progress with my sister's clarinet, actually, than I did with the flute. But ultimately, I think it was sometime around when I heard Walk, Don't Run by the Ventures,
mm-hmm.
that I decided that guitar was the sound that attracted me the most, and talked my parents into buying me a guitar, which came with 3 months of guitar lessons that I completely ignored.
Right, exactly.
And when I finally, you know, I was into the guitar and into, you know, trying to put bands together and learning every George Harrison guitar solo when the Beatles were big. And then when I got done with high school, I had like two options. I couldn't go to college. My grades weren't good enough.
Right.
I could have gone to tech school and learned computer programming because I knew something about that, even in high school in 1966, or get in a band. And fortunately, I got into a band. I got into a white blues band. And the rest is so-called history after
right.
that, I suppose.
And what was the name of your first band? Was it called Money?
That was my high school band. We
right.
called ourselves Money.
That's a little bit of projecting,
like
pay
us. You know, you always have a best friend who you're in the band where you get like big ideas with. You know, we were going to be the world's most successful high school band. We forced his brother into playing bass. He
right.
had no actual musical interests at all, but we forced him to play bass because we didn't have a bass player.
Right.
Went through three or four drummers and play some frat parties. And did mostly just, you know, all cover songs. I never even thought about writing songs of my own when I was in my high school band. But, you know, a lot of Yardbirds.
Right.
Bit of Rolling Stones, occasional Beatles. And through the Yardbirds, we got into, you know, some what to us then was obscure blues players like Sonny Boy Williamson, and also at one point there was a kid in our neighborhood who learned how to play blues harp, which we didn't even know existed at
right.
that time. But he turned us on to a whole bunch of blues while we were still in high school. In particular, Paul Butterfield, the Butterfield Band,
right.
and Junior Wells and Buddy Guy, Hoodoo Man
yeah.
Blues. You know, both the first Butterfield album and that that Junior Wells album were just like seminal, not just, I think, in my blues education, but for pretty much anyone, you know, who wanted to play the blues. And then it all spread out to like Albert King and, you know, other blues players from there.
You know, the thing is, I mean, you were born in Philadelphia, grew up in Philly. And, you know, there was so much great music going on in that region. You know, I come from a little bit more up north, Utica, New York. But, you know, that whole Northeast corridor, there was always music. I think it's because of the weather. I mean, for 6 or 8 months of the year, you know, all these kids didn't really want to go outside and stuff like that. So they would practice and the thing about the blues, you know, one of my favorites of all time and the first guy to ever give me a break on stage, his name was James Cotton.
And
you produced his 1970 Capitol release, the James Cotton Band, and you wrote a lot of those songs with guys like Danny Kortchmar and stuff like that. Tell me, like, you know, when you think about Todd Rundgren, you don't think James Cotton, you know? And, you know, but knowing what I, you know, you just said, you're like, oh, that seemed like a natural extension. How did you like go about writing songs for James? Because you're credited on at least a half a dozen of those songs on that record.
Well, that was in my sort of my early career with the Albert Grossman organization, and Albert was James Cotton's manager,
right?
As well as, you know, a lot of other people. He managed Paul Butterfield and a bunch of folk artists, of course, Bob Dylan, notably. And so they would put me together with all these artists. But I knew James before that because when I got out of high school, I got into a blues band. And we used to make regular pilgrimages to a club in New York called the Cafe Agogo.
Mm-hmm.
And the Cafe Agogo was a little underground coffee house, I guess you would call it. And in those days, the coffee house scene depended on an underage clientele. So they served no liquor at all.
Right, right.
You would get essentially like a flower vase full of milkshake. And right. That would be, you know, your drink minimum. But everybody played there. You know, yeah. I saw just like all of the blues greats play there, James Cotton amongst them, the Butterfield Band, Cream. I saw there, I sat like 6 feet from Eric Clapton's amp every night until my ears were freaking ringing.
Right.
And even, you know, I was such a rat around the place that I got to hang out there after hours when Eric Clapton showed up and did a jam session just for like the people who were left in the club with Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters, you know,
right.
Me, yeah. Like, you know, a 19-year-old white kid,
yeah.
Watching, you know, a history that nobody would ever hear. So when it came time to do James Cotton, it was like, oh, wow, this is such a golden opportunity. And my mandate at the Grossman organization would sort of modernize all of his old folk acts.
Right.
So the most important thing we did was put him together with a lot of what were then contemporary artists like Michael Bloomfield, like Johnny Winter, like Richie Fury from Little Feat.
Right.
Try and just, you know, modernize him in a way, not necessarily by writing material that wasn't bluesy so much, but putting him together with younger and certainly awe-stricken musicians, you know, to be playing with James Cotton. And he was just the sweetest guy in the world, you know, just wonderful to work with, but in that kind of way, you know, in the outsider music way, if he learned a song a certain way, he was never going to unlearn it that way.
Yeah, exactly.
And I remember there was a ballad, and he mislearned one of the notes in it.
Mm-hmm.
That was just, it was wrong every time he sang it. It sounded wrong, but there was no way we could get him to sing the right note. So we sat there with a variac, you know, which changes the speed of the tape machine.
Yes.
And every time he got to that note, we would tweak the variac so that the tape would slow down or speed up, so that when he got to that note, it would be in tune, even though when he was singing it, it was out of tune.
That's amazing. Pre-auto-tune. Like, now we take that for granted. You know, you put it on the computer screen. And
it was kind of like, it was kind of like auto-tune, but it was manual. It was not auto.
You know, I'm about to start a record. I'm going to play on it and kind of produce it with a singer named Jimmy Hall, who's a legendary Southern rock singer. And one of the songs that I had in my little bag of covers, just in case we kind of needed a new, was Kitty Boy, and you wrote it, you know.
Oh yeah.
and I was like, oh, this is, you know, this, and when I'm like doing the research, I'm like, oh, Todd wrote that, you know. And, you know, tell me about your journey from, you know, you were in a band called Nas, and you moved to New York, and you started working for Albert, you know. And, you know, did you move to New York to become a producer or a musician or a solo artist, or did you didn't care, I just want to get involved?
Well, when the Nas broke up, the Nas wasn't a very long-lived phenomenon. Probably 18 months from the time that I put the band together till the time that I left the band. And remarkably, we got three albums done, because I had envisioned the second album as a double album. But when we first went into the studio, we were looking for a producer. Mm-hmm. And we didn't know exactly what a producer did, but I made the assumption that if a record sounded good, it had to do with a producer, not knowing what the engineer's job was at that point. And as it turned out, our first album was produced by a guy named Bill Trout. And the reason why we got him is he produced a record that we liked the sound of. We originally wanted like an English producer. I wanted the producer who had done the John Mayall and the Blues Breakers album.
Mike Vernon.
Yeah, Mike Vernon, you know, because I thought he had something to do with the sound of it.
Right.
And really he didn't, you know, he just probably organized the record. But we kept getting turned down by English producers, so we got an American producer. And American producers weren't the same as English producers. English producers, as we learned, sometimes got creatively involved, like George Martin would be involved in the Beatles records. But American producers were simply there to make sure that the session didn't run long, so that it would cost the record label money if you went into a double session. So he didn't give us the sound we wanted, and I took it upon myself to start messing around, you know, remixing the album after he left. And then when we got to the second project, I declared myself producer from the get-go.
Right.
And therefore, I was going to mix the record. The manager of the Nas had a partner, and the partner actually left before I quit the band. But the partner went to work for Albert Grossman. And his mission at Albert Grossman was to find young talent, because Albert's catalog of artists were all like folk artists and blues artists, and they were all getting older. And the whole record business was changing, so they wanted young blood. And so this guy had observed me, you know, learning to be a producer on the Nas records, and invited me to come to the Albert Grossman organization, essentially to be a producer and engineer.
Right.
Because after I quit the Nas, I was on the street. I didn't have a band. I'm not even sure I had an instrument at that point.
Right.
And I was living with clothiers in the West Village.
Right.
And doing like lights in a discotheque or something like that. So he essentially plucked me off the street and dropped me into this milieu where there was all these artists whose records had become irrelevant, and just started pairing me up with them. Mm-hmm. And the first significant pairing was me engineering Jesse Winchester's record. Jesse Winchester was a conscientious objector to the Vietnam War, so he left the country and was living in Canada.
Right.
So we had to do the album in Toronto, which was actually the original stomping grounds for the band.
Robbie and all those guys, right?
Yeah, all those guys. They were playing with, what's his name, a rock and roll legend from Canada, whose name eludes me at the moment. It'll probably come back to me at an inopportune time. But,
right.
But essentially, you know, they were already a band backing up this Canadian artist. So we went to Toronto, and I engineered Jesse Winchester's first album. And I did, they were impressed enough that they made me the engineer for the band's next album, which was Stage Fright. And that was like, from a production engineering standpoint, that was my big break.
Right.
Because, you know, some people knew about Jesse Winchester, but at that point, the band was the biggest band in the world. That's how my career as a producer kind of got boosted. And then after doing a couple of projects, I was still writing songs, and I got antsy to make a vanity project, and I asked them if I could. They gave me a budget, and that was when I suddenly became an artist on my own.
And, you know, I mean, like, the kind of music, you know, you've done over the years is, I mean, like, you know, just seeing how many things you were doing all at the same time. But then I read you almost quit to become a computer engineer. I go, he knows how to carp, you know, you like put things together and, you know, what's the word, carp, you know, like, you know what I mean? It's like you're doing all this stuff at the same time. And different styles of music. And that's what I always admired about your production and your solo work. You could be working with, you know, like you said, James Cotton, you know, or you know, Meatloaf, and then doing your own solo records, which sounded completely different. I'm like going, how are you doing the left brain, right brain thing? It's like, you know, did you just have all this music in you, and did you ever sleep in the 1970s?
Well, I never made a commitment to a genre,
right?
Which most artists do at some point. You know, they, for instance, Hall & Oates is a case in point. Hall & Oates' first couple of records, I did their third record, and their first couple of records were really eclectic. You know, some of it was like folky sounding, some of it was jazzy sounding, stuff like that. Very little of it was R&B sounding.
Yeah.
You know, they were kind of an eclectic group. And on their second record, I guess, they had a big hit called She's Gone.
Yeah.
And it was like an R&B hit. You know, it sounded right, like a Jerry Ragamoy production. And then we did their third album, which was called War Babies. And Daryl was still, you know, very much an eclectic writer. He was writing all kinds of stuff. He was being heavily influenced in, to some extent, by David Bowie and, you know, and other kinds of, you know, auteur people who were writing all their own material and that sort of thing. And War Babies reflected that.
Mm-hmm.
And we turned it into their label, which was Atlantic at the time. And Atlantic said, there's no She's Gone on here.
Right.
And they dropped the band.
Right.
And it was at that point that I think they realized, okay, it's going to be She's Gone for the foreseeable future. And so they just started writing in that genre. You know, they stopped writing in like folky genres or jazzy genre. You know, everything was now like white R&B genre. And that brought them huge success. And so I think that's the way most artists think, even though they might have like more eclectic ideas in their head, that, you know, success won't come to them unless they like focus on one sort of style of music so that the audience will be untroubled, you know,
right,
the audience will know what to expect, you know, and you build your career around that. And being a producer kind of absolved me of that.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was making such a good living as a producer, I never thought about, I have to settle down and do this genre for the sake of my own commercial success. Otherwise, I won't be able to make records anymore. which was true for most artists. Unless they had some kind of success, their labels would no longer finance their music. So I never had to think that way. And so my the end result was that by the time I got to my third album, I was starting to understand songwriting and was starting to slip into a genre, and that made Something Anything the most successful record I ever did. Right. But by the time I was done making it, I thought, I don't want to write any more of those songs, you know?
Yeah.
I already wrote more than I intended to write of those kind of songs, and I have to write more of the music that's actually in my head,
yes,
you know, which is just a, more of a panorama of musical ideas than just one genre.
Yeah, you know, in my formative years, we used to take a little bit of Icon, the last track on and we used to do it. It was based on like one of the opening riffs of the song, and we just kind of would get into it, and then it would just even out, and then we would just jam for like 10 minutes, and then we go into some Yes things, and I was like, yeah, let's do something off of Utopia, because you know, like again, it's like those records. That's how it was introduced to you, was through Utopia. And to me, it was the guitar playing and the sound, the experimental nature of it. But as a blues guy, I always heard the blues in Utopia. I know it may sound weird to you for me to say that, but it was slightly anchored in blues, but it would go in so many different places because you would anchor it with the guitar playing and these kind of movements within the music.
Well, the point of Utopia, for me anyway, was really a guitar playing opportunity.
Right.
By the time I got to my third record, Something Anything, I was doing most of the writing on piano.
Mm-hmm.
And I had struggled, you know, for so long trying to become a competent guitar player that when the focus, at least the songwriting focus, moved to the piano, I started to feel like I was losing something or that I didn't want to waste all of the effort I had put in, you know, to trying to master the instrument. So Utopia was formed in part just as a way for me to play more guitar.
Right, right.
And my influences were so, you know, were essentially bluesy and maybe more specifically Yardbirdsy in that the Yardbirds produced, you know, they were guitar player factory in a way. You know?
Oh, yeah.
And I was so influenced at first by Jeff Beck and then by Eric Clapton, you know, that was sort of built in, that was baked into my musical cake. But Utopia was probably more inspired by John McLaughlin.
Right.
And the whole fusion thing that was happening at the time. Mm-hmm. So the guitar playing wasn't simply a compendium of blues riffs. The great thing about Utopia was that I was learning from the other guys in the band, you know, things that were more jazz oriented or funk oriented. But it would have to be said that there wasn't anybody in Utopia who wasn't also a blues fan, you know, who wasn't also like, it's kind of where we all started. I was thinking about it the other night, what a kind of strange evolution the blues itself has taken, in that, you know, we have a first generation of blues, which are like Robert Johnson and mm-hmm. Big Bill Brunzi and Blind Some Fruit, you know.
Yeah. Blind Lemon Jefferson. There's
a Blind Cantaloupe, something or other. Yeah. I don't know. You know, there was that first generation. Then there was a second generation, which was, you know, the James Cottons, Muddy Waters, things like that. But the third generation was essentially white.
Mm-hmm.
Because by the time it got to the third generation, black players wanted to do something else. They wanted to do R&B, other kinds of music, even rock and roll, but, you know, like Little Richard or something like that. You know, by the time it got to the third generation, black players lost interest in the blues, and then suddenly white players were the ones who picked up the torch of the blues until another generation of black players came along and got interested in the blues again. So, I mean, you and I are kind of like part of that stopgap measure, you know, of, you know, we just became more interested in the genre than what would have been logically, you know, the next generation of blues players. And that's kind of, you know, it's kind of a strange thing, but I don't think it's necessarily unusual in the entire world of music. You got to find your audience wherever they are, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, I came up, like, the first time I heard I Ain't Superstitious, it was sung by Rod Stewart, and Jeff Beck played guitar. And
exactly, you know. And the first time I saw James Cotton play live, it was for pretty much an all-white audience.
Right.
You know, it was a bunch of white kids, you know, and one of these crazy shows that would have, like, a blues artist like James Cotton, a folk artist like maybe Odetta, and then the Stooges, you know, something like that. The shows were really crazy and non-genre, non-specific in those days. And that's when a lot of those, you know, second generation blues players started to gain what essentially was an entirely white audience.
Yeah, B.B. King tells a story on film that he showed up to the Fillmore West for the first time in like the late 60s. And he thought he was in the wrong place because his entire audience was like white hippie kids. And he went to Bill Cramby. He's like, we must have made a mistake in the booking. He's like, no, they're here for you. You know, and that was the shift in the music.
And they're on acid.
Right. Yeah, the acid light shows back then. You know, are there any similarities? Because you were saying, like, you know, with James Cotton, if he learned it a certain way, that was it. It's like, it's ingrained. Are there any similarities in producing blues artists in like punk bands like the New York Dolls, XTC, you know, stuff like that? You produced the New York Dolls for legendary first record and XTC and genres like that. I mean, are there any similarities in like the kind of like, well, these are musicians that just do it a certain way, so it's my job to just capture it, or are they more malleable?
Oh no, with the New York Dolls, it was definitely that was the apotheosis of white blues, you know, in that no, they weren't gonna learn it any other way.
Right.
There were no musical suggestions I could make except maybe you know, don't snort so much cocaine before the next take, you know, because you're playing faster than the rest of the band. But otherwise, no, it was more like just hoping that they would all play together at some point. And you know, that the distractions would fade into the background momentarily, and they would, you know, and they would all kind of like focus and somebody wouldn't like screw up too badly. And in that sense, I guess, you know, it is the white analog of, you know, the original blues in a way, in that they, you know, there was kind of like a certain lid on it, and I don't know whether it was self-conscious or not, but you know, it was they were like a seminal band in the so-called punk rock movement, not because they called themselves punk rock.
Right.
In those days, it was just the New York scene. There were a bunch of bands in New York, and they got it into their heads that anybody could play.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, that, you know, the more of a naif you were, you know, the better, you know. If you learned how to play your instrument, you were a poser. You know, you're not supposed to learn things, you know. You're just supposed to play it. Pick it up and play it. That's it.
Yeah. You know, it's funny.
That was the movement that caused a bunch of rock critics to form their own bands, because it was finally something they could understand.
it was attainable.
And so, yeah, it's really just like, it's almost like field recording, you know, almost like going out and, you know, finding some obscure gospel group somewhere and capturing them for the Library of Congress.
Yeah, like
it's only going to, you know, it's either going to work or it's not going to work. But in those days, you couldn't even talk to them like they were a group. Mm-hmm. You know, they were a bunch of randomly assembled personalities.
Right. On a percentage basis, how much is the art of producing records psychology, and how much is it trying to herd cats?
Well, when I first started out, I was not aware of the importance of the psychological aspect of what a producer does. It's not to say that I have fully adapted to the role of psychoanalyst, you know,
yeah, right.
when I'm in the studio. It's really, to me, like the last resort. Mm-hmm. It's like when you can't, like, convince somebody on musical terms and then you have to, like, just play on their ego, something like that.
Right.
It's likely the reason why I never did produce Janis Joplin's first record.
Right.
I was in Mill Valley doing all the prep work for the record.
Mm-hmm.
Her band, which was called the Full Tilt Boogie Band, was just a temporary assemblage of musicians who were there to learn songs so that she could sing them and decide whether she wanted to do them. But I had never met an artist who was so into the process
yeah.
of like making a record, getting ready to make a record, anything to do with the record itself.
Yeah.
If you recall it, Big Brother and the Holding Company, which was Janis Joplin's first band, their first record was live. Most of it was live.
Yeah.
And the reason why is because she just hated being in the studio.
Yeah.
Because there's no audience. You know, mm-hmm. she only enjoyed it if she got some response to what she was doing. And I only learned that, I learned it when it was too late.
Right.
Somebody sent us a song from the Grossman office. He had songwriters on salary there, and somebody had come up with a song that they thought would work for Janis, and they essentially said, "You're doing this." Mm-hmm. No, they didn't ask us if we were doing it. They said, right. "You're doing this."
Right.
And they also said, "And here's another idea. You're doing it with the Butterfield Band."
Yeah.
And they had never worked together before. There was no history between them. They were both just managed by Albert. And so they put us in a studio in L.A., me and Janis and the Butterfield Band, to try and learn and get a take on this song. Mm-hmm. And never caught on. It never just, nobody at any point thought, oh, this is great. You know, everyone felt a little put upon by having to do that particular song. And that was when I realized that Janis didn't like being in a studio, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, just little enthusiasm for the process at all. And that's when they got a different producer. They got Paul Rothschild, mm-hmm. I remember, who was a producer for The Doors. And he was like the polar opposite of me. I was very much, the first thing that I worry about is the music.
Yeah.
You know, is this a good song? Is this worth everybody's effort?
Right.
Is it worth our effort to do? And is it worth the audience's effort to listen to?
Listen.
You know, so that's the first thing that I worry about. Second thing I worry about is, you know, can we please perform this with some enthusiasm, you know, or sincerity or something? You know, that's the next thing. Very last thing I worry about is the sound, because the audience doesn't worry about the sound.
Right.
Whenever they hear it, they think that's what it's supposed to sound like, you know.
Yeah.
But if it's a crappy song, they won't be interested in hearing it.
Right.
And if it's, you know, and if it's a lackluster performance, why should they want to hear it? So those were always my priorities. Paul Rothschild, in my estimation, knew very little about music, actually. Mm-hmm. You know, he could never say, could you make that, you know, G minor 7 instead of G minor. You could never do that. You know,
right.
He wouldn't know what that meant. But
yeah.
He would know how to say, that was great.
Mm-hmm.
That was great. So let's just do one more, you know.
Yeah.
And eventually, you know, by coaxing one more performance out of them, you eventually get to the performance that you need. But I was never really very good at that part of it, of, you know, massaging the artist to the point that, you know, I refined my process to be, first of all, send me all the material that you want on the record, because
right.
we don't want to go in the studio and suddenly be staring at each other because we ran out of material.
Yeah.
And I, you know, would like us all to have the confidence when we go into the studio that we've got all the material we need to make the record. Second, it would be great if you knew the material before you came into the studio. You know, ideally, right, you played it in front of an audience, you know, so you know what works and, you know, and where to put your emphasis and that sort of thing.
And that's and, a lost art. That process
has worked out pretty well, actually.
Yeah. You know, that's a lost art. I mean, usually bands had the material and they toured it for months before, and then they would make the record. Now it's you make the record, then go tour for months. The whole process has kind of gotten reversed, you know, because we live in the age of now, like, you know, your whole new record could be put on YouTube and before you even get in the studio and record it, you know. You know, one of the things I wanted to ask you about was, obviously we were talking about, like, I call them the British Three Kings, Beck, Page, Clapton, you know, the Yardbirds people, and you know, you were tasked with producing Grand Funk Railroad, and you came up with your analysis of the band is like, okay, we can't make another Cream here. They're not these kind of players, but they are from Detroit, and we're going to make it so it's going to be, let's celebrate the music of Detroit within this the context of this three-piece group. And you produced a record called We're an American Band, which I'm sorry, it didn't sell that many copies because, I mean, those kids had promise, you know?
Well, it was kind of a golden opportunity and also kind of characteristic of the way my production career went. You know, I would commonly be put together with problem acts, you know,
right,
people who had issues getting a record done, that mm-hmm. sort of thing. Especially in the case of like Badfinger, because by the time I got involved, it was the third pass at making a record. You know, they had already gone through two producers.
And you inherited the project from George Harrison.
Yeah, they had gone through Jeff Emmerich that had done a whole album with them. He was the engineer on the Beatles' kind of last records, something like Sgt. Pepper and Onward. And I guess the American label weren't excited about the end product. And then George got involved and then got disinvolved because of the concert for Bangladesh. Mm-hmm. And that's when I wound up with that project. And, you know, turning what was a dumpster fire into a hit record suddenly, right, you know, certainly burnished my career. And so Grand Funk realized they needed a transformation of some kind at that point, because yeah, people were making all sorts of assumptions about the band. Mm-hmm. That, you know, they weren't very good songwriters, as evidenced by the fact that they would write like just kind of like a song structure and jam for 20 minutes, you know,
right,
because they thought of themselves as like Cream, but they weren't Cream, you know, right, they were not that sophisticated. And and they came to their senses. They got rid of their old management, which was part of the problem in terms of making their records, because their manager was producing their records and he was a terrible producer,
right,
and got to the business of writing songs instead of just simply frameworks for jamming over.
Right.
And had the whole record planned out beforehand. They had all the material, but they also knew that it would be called We're an American Band, and they also knew that the lead single would be the title song,
mm-hmm.
and they also knew exactly when it would be released, and so that, you know, the entire production of the album was all on a kind of like a strict timeline in a way. We went into the studio the first day, Criterion Studios in Miami, and recorded the track for We're an American Band. And then the next day we came in and finished it, did the vocals and other overdubs, mixed it, and went immediately into the mastering lab that was in Criteria,
right,
and cut the single. And we didn't even have a B-side yet because we hadn't recorded anything else.
Right.
But we cut the single. And it went off to the pressing plant, and in less than a week, the DJ copies were out at radio. And this was in the days when you could chart a record without actually having sold anything. You could chart a record on pre-orders, you know, right. whatever record stores would order before you had actually really sold anything. And so the amazing thing was, a week after that, week after we mastered the single is in the top 40.
Right.
It's already at radio. And it's in the top 40. And we're still working on the record.
Yeah.
And by the time we finish the record, it's in the top 5.
Wow.
And then it goes to number 1, you know, like the week after we finish the record, and stays there for several weeks. And then we had a second hit single off of the record as well. And then we did another record and had a hit single off of that. So essentially it was a transformation of a jam band into a top 40 band, and all done according to a formula that fortunately for everyone just came off like clockwork.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's this right song at the right time with the right production and everything, and that's, you know, that's how those things explode. You know, like you mentioned before, like you know, you were a bit of a magnet for troubled productions, and you inherit these things and make diamonds. You know, I always tell people, it's like, never change a tire for your friend, because that'll get around, because the next time another friend needs a tire change, they're going to call you, you know?
Yeah.
And one of the things I wanted to ask you about was, and it was a place I always wanted to work, but I never got to, because I just didn't have a record deal and a reason to be there at the time, was Bearsville Studio. And that was, you know, being from upstate New York, that was always like Bearsville's. That's, you know, place Todd Rundgren built and did all his records. And it was like this mythical place. I never got to work there. What was it about that studio that, you know, because to me that almost is like the American Abbey Road, or the, you know, the East Coast Capitol, or, you know, whatever. It's in the, you know, halcyon of great studios. What was it about that room that you took to so well and were able to, you know, do projects there, like, you know, like Bat Out of Hell, which you inherited, and there was no deal, and you made that record?
Well, I pretty much know the entire history of that room.
Mm-hmm.
Because it didn't start in that room. Stage Fright was the first big production that I got involved in for Bearsville. And we recorded that record, most of it, in the Woodstock Playhouse, which was a summer stock theater in the town of Woodstock. And Albert bought a remote recording truck. And we took all the equipment out of the truck and we put it into the prop tent behind the playhouse.
Right.
And that's where I spent, you know, the summer that we did Stage Fright, mostly in the prop tent behind the playhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And it was sweltering hot in the daytime and freezing cold at night because it's up in the Catskills.
Yeah.
And when we finished the basic recording, we set about doing overdubs and a little bit more recording. All of that was done in a couple of studios in New York City. And when we moved out of the playhouse and went to New York City, they took the equipment, the board and everything, and moved it into what was a brand new, what they called Studio C, which was the small room, or it might have been Studio B. There was a huge room that they intended to do like symphonies in.
Mm.
You know, that was Studio A. And that studio actually almost never got used. Right. And indeed, for many years, it didn't even have a console in it. You know, it was just a big room. As a matter of fact, for a while, it was my video studio.
Right.
Instead of an actual recording room. So Studio C or Studio B, whatever it was, the smaller room, they moved all the equipment into there. And they were still actually working on the room itself. And it was one of John Storick's first room. And probably the name John Storick is unfamiliar to the average person, but John Storick became probably the first big name in studio design, designing studios, and he's designed them all over the world. Some of them are like multi-million dollar, you know, creations, and that was one of his first significant creations. So they moved all the equipment into that room, and wound up doing the final mixes of Stage Fright in the room. But there was, but we didn't record anything. That was all done in the control room. Nothing was done in the actual studio itself. Eventually, they got it finished, and then called the very first session in the studio, and I was there to supervise the session. And the very first session was Van Morrison. And it was right before his big string of hit records for Warner Brothers.
Right.
You know, Domino and Jackie Wilson Said and all his other great songs before that. So he was kind of test flying his whole band and his new material. And he came into the studio and we worked for like a couple hours. And then he called the session. He hated the sound.
Oh, wow.
Hated the sound of the studio. That was the very first session. So I'm not sure what they did after that, you know, but...
Yeah.
And I did occasional sessions in there, but I had my own studio, actually,
right,
that I did most of my records in. And the most significant project I ever did was Bat Outta Hell in that same studio.
Right. Tell me, like, one of the things, like, people don't know about you, it's like, well, maybe a lot of people do, but you're equal parts musician, producer, and inventor. You know, you're one of the first people to embrace the... you know, computer technology in the, you know, you even invented a tablet for that you licensed to Apple and all of this stuff. And, you know, when I listen to music now, it's people, you know, I don't know anybody who's done a record on tape. You know, that's a bygone era, you know, and you were one of the, you know, pioneering producers to just go, no, this, let's embrace this digital thing. When you listen to records now, do you think it's gone too far in the way you can manipulate sound, or is it just beginning and music 100 years from now will be almost unrecognizable to the music that we listen to today?
Well, first I'd like to clarify a couple of misconceptions. I wouldn't call myself an inventor per se, in that, you know, I have not ever made a thing.
Right.
I can legitimately call myself a computer programmer or mm-hmm. a software developer, because
right.
I've actually had software products come out. Right. And my first association with Apple was to write software for a hardware device they had called a graphics tablet.
Right.
And that was the first software that I ever published. And then after that, I got like a screensaver called Flow Phaser published at a certain point, and you know, I've done other software related things, so I'm confident calling myself a computer programmer,
right.
but not so confident calling myself an inventor. But my relationship to technology is not necessarily that I'm always an early adopter. I'm not always an early adopter. I try and figure out, you know, how useful a certain thing is for me. Mm-hmm. And if it's useful, then I'll learn how to use it. But if I don't see the use in it, I won't necessarily make the effort. So right. when it came to digital recording, I held on to the analog for a long time.
Right.
I didn't like jump right on it. Mostly it was the expense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was almost an order of magnitude more expensive to move from analog to digital in the early days.
Right.
And so I kind of avoided it. And when I did go, I went with a kind of a weird hybrid intermediate technology called, I'm trying to remember, but essentially it was using VHS machines to record audio, digital audio.
Oh, ADATs?
ADATs, that's it, right.
Right.
For a while I got into the ADATs. And I didn't get into the ADATs necessarily because they were digital. I got into the ADATs because I was reading a book about the Beatles recording sessions. and how they did their recording. And of course, they started out when there was when everything was mono, and then and evolved until probably 8-track. You know, they didn't get they didn't make records much past 8-track, but their process was mostly like you would record a track on the onto stereo tape, and then you would bounce to another stereo tape and add anything that you wanted, and you might do that several times.
Right.
And so the process of making for the records for them was a lot of bouncing back and forth of stereo tapes, and that allowed them to go back and, you know, if they had sort of wandered off into the weeds with an idea, they say, oh, let's go back to that tape we had 2 weeks ago, because they never recorded over anything. You know, they kept everything that they did and say, well, let's go back to that thing 2 weeks ago, and then they start over again, you know, bouncing stuff back and forth.
Right.
And so I got into the ADATs because while there were only 8 tracks to an ADAT, you could eject a tape and stick another tape in and have as many takes as you wanted of something.
Right.
So you could go back, you know, you could recover old takes and that sort of thing. So that's why I got into it, not necessarily because it was digital. And in the end, it turned out to be a big pain in the ass anyway.
Right.
So I didn't go fully commit to digital until like late in the 90s when I got my first Pro Tools system. And at first, you know, I got into it. It was convenient in some ways, again, more expensive than analog in other ways. But I managed to get through that phase because DigiDesign, the company that did Pro Tools, was that was their only product, was Pro Tools. And so you knew somebody at DigiDesign, you know, and you say, I'm having a problem here, which you often did, you know, because it involved disk drives, you know, and hardware cards that plugged in to your computer and external interfaces. It was, you know, a really elaborate technical sort of system. And then Avid bought DigiDesign, and then you couldn't get a hold of anybody anymore.
Yeah.
And I found, you know, the weather out here is especially humid. I'm in Hawaii, by the way.
Right.
And have been for 25 years. And I would go on the road for 6 months and come back, turn my system on, and smoke would come out of the carts, you know?
Yeah, the salt air, it corrodes
everything. Yeah, the whole nightmare scenario every time I turn the system on. So I eventually went to, you know, software-only solution called Reason. Mm-hmm. And now I'm fully committed, fully digital, blah, blah, blah. Doesn't require any special hardware. And I know the people at the company in case I get in trouble.
Yeah.
So, so it's been kind of like I backed into everything. But I only do it if it's sort of, you know, if it works for me and it doesn't hinder the process.
Right.
You know, you have to still be able to make progress and make music. You know, you don't want the technology to get in the way all the time.
You know, it's funny because, like, you know, my first solo album I did on analog, and we still own like 50 reels of analog, you know, Ampex tape or whatever. And then all the rest of my I did digitally, and my entire catalog of 45 albums, both live, everything, can fit on a hard drive that's this big.
Exactly.
You know, and you're like going, this is your life in music? This you know,
smaller than that, actually.
Smaller than that, yeah. And you know, I mean you were doing, like, you know, interactive records and things like that. And you know, tell people, speaking of interactive, tell people about the virtual tour that you're going to do. Because, you know, like all of us, we can't play in front of humanoids, and we'd like to keep playing just to prove we can.
Exactly.
You know?
Well, it was just a couple of years ago, I started to change the way that I toured to try and get more of the traveling out of it. You know, the worst part about touring, as anyone will tell you, is the traveling part. The playing's great, but the traveling is the worst. And so I changed my touring to be more sort of primary markets than going to every market. You know, typical routing will be you'll play a big city like Chicago, and then you'll wind up playing some smaller cities to get to the next big city.
Right.
And a long time ago, I sort of mandated that, you know, my ideal thing is two on and one off, because I sing for at least 2 hours a night. And I can do that two nights in a row, but then I need a day to rest.
Right.
And so we changed the touring to be like at least two nights in a major market,
mm-hmm.
and then 2 days off, and then fly to the next market.
Right.
And that gives the crew plenty of time to move everything to the next city. Gives me plenty of time to rest. Also eliminates, you know, traveling by bus.
Right.
You know, because you won't rent a bus to travel once every 5 days.
Yeah.
So wind up flying most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I find myself ever more often in the airport waiting for a delayed flight and panicking, mm-hmm. you know, because am I going to get to the freaking gig? And then the flight is canceled and it goes into total freak out mode with my travel agent, you know, trying to find some way to get to the gig. And it occurs to me that this is going to happen more and more often because the primary cause is climate change.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, ever more often there are storms, particularly in the Atlantic, and that'll shut down a major hub like Miami or Atlanta or New York, LaGuardia, something like that. And once a major hub gets shut down, it like ricochets to the entire system.
Right.
So I started to think, well, what do I do if I can't get to the gig? You know, it isn't just flying. Even if you were doing a bus tour, you couldn't have toured California last summer. The whole state was on fire.
Right. Know? Exactly. Exactly.
You know, and you couldn't have toured half of Texas. It was underwater. You know, so this is going to happen like more and more often. How do I get to the gig, you know, when everything is against me getting to the gig? And it started to occur to me that maybe we do like a virtual thing. We set up in a venue and then we broadcast to other venues because almost all venues have video now. So you sell tickets just like you usually would. And people have the same sort of concert experience that they would have had. Except that you're not there, you know, you're doing the show virtually. Well, then we have a pandemic and the audience can't go to the gig either. And that's when you realize you've got to go full virtual. You've got to bring a show to their home. And now you're losing a lot of the experience once you do that.
Yeah.
Because now they're not going to the gig. And all the things that make it sort of special, you know, when you or I, you know, say that we're coming to somebody's town, they'll make plans around it. You know, a lot of people will rush out and get their favorite seats, you know, so you'll get a big burst of ticket sales right off the bat, you know, and then they'll hire the babysitter and they'll, you know, maybe make plans for dinner and stuff. Yeah. So it'll be a whole event for them. And they'll go to the gig and they'll see people that sometimes they only see when they go out to, you know, see another gig. They live at the opposite end of town or something like that. But they'll see familiar faces and, you know, they'll have a whole, you know, night of it. How do we maintain as much of that as possible? And the big component about it is that locality. You know, what's unique about that place? Not simply for the people who live there, because they know what's unique about it.
Yeah.
You know, for us, the players, you know, it's not just, you know, the traveling is horrible, but being someplace is not necessarily horrible. Most every place that you go on tour, you've probably been to before and you know, you see fans that you've seen before, you recognize them. There are walks you like to take and landmarks you might like to see. Restaurants you like to eat at, you know,
guitar shops,
particular hotel you like to stay at, that sort of thing, you know. You enjoy that locality as much as they do, maybe more because you're only visiting.
Right.
So the biggest challenge in terms of doing a virtual tour, which we're doing, starting on February 14th, we'll play 25 cities, 25 shows. each in a different major market. And each one of those will be localized. Essentially, for the audience, as much as we can, as much as we can make it feel local for them, but just as importantly for us, the performers.
Right.
You know, 25 shows in the same venue is almost like being in a Holiday Inn.
It's Vegas. Like, it's getting close to Vegas.
Or Las Vegas residency or something like that, all of that locality is going out of it. So we're going to self-hypnotize for every city that we play. We'll completely dress the backstage area like we were there and put up posters of local landmarks, and have the local newspapers laying around and get catering from an eatery in that city if we can.
Right. That's great.
Or at
idea.
Least get the recipe, and cook it for ourselves. And set the clocks to the local time where we're playing.
Right.
Which is why we're doing everything out of Chicago, so we won't be like totally, otherwise I would have done it from Hawaii, but that mean we'd be playing shows at 3 p.m. So
So
doing it from a central time zone takes the edge off in terms of, are playing the shows in different time zones. So, it's a whole exercise in convincing ourselves we're there as much as convincing the audience we're there, because they're already there.
It's a great idea. The fact that you dress up the backstage, tonight it looks like the Chicago Theater, tomorrow night it's the Beacon or, whatever. And it's like, that's a great idea, because I mean, people are clamoring for, they want to go see shows again. They miss live music. They miss the connection with their artist and a lot of artists, miss the connection with the audience. So I think that's fantastic. It's a great idea. That's the coolest virtual, tour I've heard of. The fact that you're localizing it and making it so it's like tonight feels like Cleveland and San Francisco and stuff like that.
It's also a very dangerous idea.
You could ruin it for the rest of us.
Well, I had to convince Live Nation, who's been doing my tours lately, to even allow me to do it, because I had already committed to a tour with them.
Right.
And when they moved it from February to this coming October, I said, well, now you have to let me do this experiment. But it is an experiment. We're learning a lot all the time. And, by the time we do the first gig, I'll be committed to the tune of about $1 million to pull this off.
Yeah, it's not cheap.
At this point, ticket sales would not justify that, because the whole dynamic is different.
Right.
People are smart enough to know that it isn't a real gig, it's a virtual gig. So they won't rush out like they normally do, to get a particular seat. They'll probably stall as long as possible, especially considering, that a lot of people are in, dicey financial straits at this point. Mm-hmm. And it's also, I think, affected people's ability to focus on other things, what's happening now.
Right.
Because since we announced the tour, we've had an election, we had post-election controversy, had a runoff election, a riot in the Capitol. But, hopefully things are going to settle down pretty soon. And people will start thinking, okay, now I'm bored. What am I going to do? And I'm going to be pretty much the only show in town.
No kidding. I people ask me, we did a live stream at the Ryman Auditorium for the same reasons, centrally located. The people in Europe have to stay up late, and people in Hawaii will get up early in Australia. And as a concert promoter, because we promote our own shows, people are asking, so what are the ticket sales like, and what's doing something like that? Like I said, it's the worst as a concert promoter, because it's like doing a GA show, walk-up ticket only. Spend all this money on production, and we started to see big ticket sales about 72 hours from the event. All of a sudden, the graph just goes like that, and you're like, because they're not worried about front row. Everybody's front row, because they're watching on their phone or their television. It is a crazy thing. I would be remiss as a guitar collector, and I would get tons of crap from my guitar collecting friends as we wrap up here, if I didn't ask you about a particular guitar you used to own called the Fool. And my question is, did you get it from Jackie Lomax?
I got it from Jackie Lomax. My history with the Fool is somewhat connected to my history with Eric Clapton. I've admitted I was just like total Eric Clapton fanboy when I was 18.
Yeah.
You know, everybody, when they heard that Blues Breakers record, you know, it was like your balls fell on the floor, you know, and everybody realized entirely new ball game now. You know, somebody has defined, you know, a direction. This is where you're all going now.
Right.
And so the first time I laid eyes on the Fool was the first time Cream played in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had seen pictures of Eric Clapton before, but I had never seen him play live, and I had never seen Cream play live. The only thing I knew was like pictures from the album cover. And it was a Murray the K show. Murray the K was a DJ in New York, and he would occasionally do these rock extravaganzas in a theater in Brooklyn, like a Paramount Theater or something like that. And acts would come on, and they do like two songs.
Mm-hmm.
And they do like five shows a day, something like that.
Right.
And this particular show, the headliners were like, it was like Mitch Ryder, post Detroit Wheels,
right,
and Wilson Pickett. They traded finishing the show, but you saw Mitch Ryder and Wilson Pickett. They wrapped the show up. But then there was like the Blues Project and the Blues Magoos. Everybody had blues in their name,
right?
And also on the show were the first American appearances of The Who and Cream.
Wow.
So the first time I saw them live was the Murray the K show. And they both knocked my dick in the dirt, but for different reasons.
Right.
When you saw The Who for the first time, you thought, this is where rock and roll is going.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't just some, you know, you thought it was the Beatles, you know, tapping your toes, you know, and smiling and playing the song. The Who, you didn't know who to look at, you know?
Yeah.
Pete's like windmilling and jumping around and stuff and stabbing his amp. And Keith is like an octopus, you know?
Yeah.
And Roger's flinging his mic 20 feet out over the audience and stuff like that and somehow never hits anybody with it.
Right.
And John Entwistle just standing there, but his fingers are flying a mile a minute. And they're all dressed up really, you know, in costumes and stuff. And you're like, man, this is most entertaining thing I've ever seen, you know. And how are we going to top that? And from then on, I was like, any opportunity I can to smash a guitar, I'm going to take it. And then Cream came on. And they had these painted instruments, you know, which I hadn't seen before.
Right.
You know, and I always thought he played standard Les Paul. And now he's playing Les Paul Jr., you know, or not a Les Paul Jr., but what we call the Mary Ford guitar.
Right. The
SG. And they had their hair permed, all really big, you know.
Yeah.
Eric had an afro. He had a blonde afro. And they played two songs. They played I'm So Glad and another song. They didn't play I Feel Free for some reason, which was the single off of their first record. And it was after that they started doing a series of gigs at the Cafe Agogo, you know, a little underground club where I saw like all of these blues players and where I saw Cream. And I stood and I sat, made sure I got there early, sat in the very front row. And this was a small club set up pointing at the narrow way. In other words, it's really wide, but the stage is in the center, pointing at the other wall. And there's only maybe five rows of seats, and then everyone's sitting out this way. And I'm like 6 feet from his amp every single show.
Right.
With my ears ringing, you know.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't care. I'm staring at his hands the entire show, watching him play that guitar. Years later, you know, I'm not living in Woodstock yet, but I'm up in Woodstock, and someone contacted me and said, Jackie Lomax has Eric Clapton's guitar, and he wants to sell it.
Right.
So I went over to Jackie's house, and he shows me the guitar, and the guitar is in just horrible shape. Mm-hmm. He'd been using it as a lap guitar.
Right.
Replaced the old bridge with a wooden bridge.
Yeah.
The action was like this. He'd been using it as a lap guitar.
Wow.
A slide guitar. The paint was all chipped off of it. You know, the back of it, almost all the paint came off. Scraped off by like belt buckles that
right.
Eric had worn, and the paint at the, you know, right at the near the headstock was all worn off, and the wood was like balsa wood because he had sweated so much right. onto that part of the neck, and eventually, after I bought the guitar, the headstock snapped off
right.
and had to be replaced, but he wanted $500 for it. He had so little regard for the guitar at that point. He wanted $500. He said, maybe I'll buy it back from you someday. And I said to myself, fat chance.
You're right.
And so I acquired the guitar, and I got an artist friend of mine to retouch the paint job and seal it. It had never been sealed. That's why all the paint had been coming yeah. off. And eventually the headstock snapped off, and I had to have that replaced. And I played that guitar for a long time. And in the late 80s, I was playing in Japan, and a guy approached me, and he had an exact replica of the guitar.
Yeah.
He had gone and gotten the same model year SG.
Right.
And painted it from pictures that he found in a magazine and gifted me the guitar.
Wow.
And after that, I pretty much played that guitar exclusively.
Right.
Because the Fool, the original guitar, I think they had taken some windings off the pickup to give it a sharper sound.
Right.
So when you compare the two, the replica had a more full-bodied sound right. than the original. So I began to play the replica. And then in the mid-90s, I get in trouble with the IRS. And I had to auction the guitar off.
Right.
In order to get out of trouble with the IRS. This was after Eric's original auction, where Brownie went for like $550,000.
Right, right.
And so I got involved with Sotheby's, did their first kind of online musical auction. They did a terrible job.
Right.
It was awful, an awful experience. So I don't know exactly where that guitar is now, but
I'm not sure either.
I do still have the replica.
Well, you know, a lot of times, you know, like I've played Rory Gallagher's guitar, I've played Peter Green's, I've played, I played Blackie, Eric Clapton's Strat. And a lot of times, if they're not really maintained, they're not in great condition. They're not really as instruments. They look the same. You're like, oh my God, this thing has got to be magical. And then you play it, and it's kind of, you just go, okay, this thing needs a little bit of work, maybe some frets and, you know. But again, Todd, I cannot thank you enough for doing this, man. It's like it's an honor of a lifetime for me to talk to you and share stories. I mean, he's just one of my heroes, and you know, it's always nice when you meet your heroes. And we've met a couple times before, but when your heroes are nice guys, you know, that's always a big deal. I've met a couple of my heroes, and I wish I should have just stayed over there, but. I think
I have to say, Steve Lukather always said that you're one of the nicest guys in the world, and this has confirmed that for me as well. So, you know, it's been a real pleasure, and let's do it again sometime.
Let's do it again. Ladies and gentlemen, again, what can I say? Todd Rundgren. This has been Live from Nerdville. Thank you very much. Until next time.